Good morning. It's good to see so many people here at bright and early this morning. I'm Pat Berger, the chair of the Mongolia Initiative here at Berkeley. And for those of you who were here yesterday, you know that we had a panel. Three of the speakers spoke yesterday, but we have one more speaker today from that panel who is actually going to be talking about something that we might well have started with, in fact, because it has to do with archaeology. And that's William Fitzhugh, who comes to us from the Smithsonian Institution. William Fitzhugh is the curator of archaeology and director of the Arctic Studies Center at the Smithsonian. He is a specialist in circumpolar archaeology, northern cultures, and environments, and he conducts fieldwork and research on circumpolar archaeology, etc., with special attention to human-environmental interactions. As a curator, of course, he also initiates, develops, and produces exhibitions and public programs, which is a wonderful thing, I know myself, and he prepares scholarly and popular publications, websites, films, and other products, and serves as an advisor for graduate students and PhD students, and instructs undergraduates and interns, etc., as in his role as a visiting professor at Dartmouth College. So I'd like very much to welcome William Fitzhugh to the podium. His talk today is Deadly Modernity and the Future of Mongolia's Past. Let's give him a warm welcome.
Well, it's great to be the tail end of a project early in the morning. I was afraid I wasn't going to be here until, I was initially planned to get in last night. I'm in the middle of giving my final exams at Dartmouth, and the students were almost not going to let me leave, but then they realized that there might be a chance of no exam. They said, go. So I have to leave late tonight to get back and do that. What I'd like to do is really two things today. I'm going to talk about something different than the abstract reads in your paper. After I realized really what the focus of the conference was, I thought, gee, I should talk a little bit more about the heritage preservation needs. And so I'll do that in the written part of the paper, and then quickly go through some images of some of the Dierkes work that we've been doing, so that you get a little bit of sense of the new research on those wonderful artifacts. And as I just told Patricia, the Dierkes are really the beginning of art history in Mongolia. It's the first instance in which we have real art show up in that whole land. And it shows up unannounced and on stone, so it's lasted a long time. So we're very fortunate. So I just arrow through. Yeah, Mongolia is one of the world's great cultural treasures. Its landscapes, if not its animals, hark back hundreds of thousands of years. Glacials, interglacials, and dinosaurs have come and gone, as have forests and deserts. But for all this physical and biological change, humans and their ancestors probably walked lands that were recognizably Mongolian. We know these Mongolian ancestors from rock art and archaeological sites, from burials and monuments, and from places venerated with ovos. By the Bronze Age, 3,000 years ago, we have the first evidence of monumental art revealing a shamanic tradition still living today. From those days, and probably long before, came Mongolia's artistic and musical traditions, distinctive costumes, and foods for daily and ceremonial use. Mongolia's cultural identity has much deeper past than its written history from Turkic times or the reports of visitors to the Khan's court. Preservation of this history is important not only to Mongolians, but to the entire world. Mongolia is the only national culture that preserves the traditions of a still extant nomadic society that has survived the agricultural and industrial revolutions. Mongolia has a special place in history, but that place is now challenged by the forces of progress so necessary for sustaining Mongolia's future. So what might we be able to say about Mongolia 100 years from today? Considering the pace of current change, would we recognize the land, its peoples, its cultures and traditions? Does modernity require the loss of Mongolia's ancient heritage? Many cultures have faced the dilemma of rampant progress only to discover that what's been lost cannot be retrieved. In some areas of the world, newly independent people like the Inuit are finding a middle ground. The problems of Mongolia's culture are readily apparent. Archaeological sites are being looted. Historic objects are being sold overseas. Mining and industrial development have destroyed historical and contemporary cultural landscapes, sites, and traditions. The World Monument Fund has helped restore some high-profile monuments and monasteries. And more effective government policies have begun to enforce the export of antiquities and paleontological materials. Nevertheless, much more needs to be done to inventory, preserve, and document earlier and less prominent monuments and sites that comprise the bulk of Mongolia's heritage. These materials are of special interest to the local people who have lived with them, with these sites and landmarks for centuries and stand to benefit most from their survival. Even archaeological salvage has created its own burdens of storage, preservation, and record keeping. To help here, the Smithsonian and the American Center for Mongolian Studies have been collaborating with Mongolian museums, institutes, and cultural agencies to facilitate archaeological research, site preservation, collection management, and conservation. The loss of Mongolia's natural and cultural heritage came dramatically to the world's attention when the skeleton of the dinosaur T. Bator appeared for sale on eBay several years ago. This nearly complete skeleton had been spirited out of Mongolia to the USA by dealers who disguised their activities by breaking their shipment down into small bone units that could not be recognized as a significant portion of a complete animal. When the theft was uncovered, the individuals involved were indicted, and the reassembled skeleton was returned and put on display in Souk Bator Square. The Smithsonian assisted the recovery effort and has since become involved in training U.S. customs officials to enforce Mongolia's heritage export laws. The key to such work is the accurate description of fossils, monuments, and artifacts, without which legal enforcement is impossible. For the past 15 years, the Smithsonian and the Mongolian National Museum have been engaged in several research activities in Mongolia, including archaeological studies of Mongolia's late Bronze Age deer stones, religious shrines called ovos, the mapping and interpretation of empire capital sites, early empires, and several zoological studies. The deer stone project investigated the age, cultural relations, and iconography of Mongolia's earliest megalithic monuments, and succeeded in dating these iconic manifestations to 1,500 years before Christ, proving that the Scythian-style carvings preceded the famous Scythian and Sakha cultures of Central and Western Asia by 500 to 800 years. Standing unprotected in the Mongolian steppe for 3,000 years, these elaborately carved monuments have become symbolic of Mongolia's contributions to world heritage 2,000 years before the days of the Mongol Empire. In recent decades, these monuments have become targets of theft and desecration, along with many of Mongolia's precious rock art and archaeological sites. Soon after the establishment of the Karakoram Museum at the site of the Mongol Empire capital city, three of its statues were stolen, and though they were later recovered, the lack of detailed object descriptions often made it difficult to legally confiscate antiquities as they passed through international borders. Recovering recent thefts from Mongolia's museums have been similarly disadvantaged by the lack of a detailed systematic record and inventory. Today, a Mongolian law requires detailed recording and inventory of all archaeological remains, but there's presently still little cross-institution agreement on standardized data formats and software. Some Mongolian institutions still work with paper records and outmoded security systems. Mongolia is not alone in having inadequate records of cultural properties. Their increasing value has made looting and trafficking a rampant problem worldwide. The solution requires education, enforcement, and most importantly, better documentation of cultural patrimony. Some problems, like the melting of the frozen Pazaric tombs of Western Mongolia, Kazakhstan, and Southern Russia, will be tragic and inescapable losses of global warming. But we should at least prioritize urgent fieldwork and try to better document what is known. For the past several years, the Smithsonian and the ACMS have been working with the Mongolian agencies to develop better systems for registering and recording archaeological monuments and remains. The problems facing Mongolia are similar to those facing most other places in the world: a need for object conservation and registration systems to facilitate research and collection management, enhance object and data security, Globally, the need has stimulated banks, foundations, granting agencies, and insurance companies to require detailed records for research and exhibition of objects. The swashbuckling days of Harrison Ford archaeology or Roy Chapman Andrews paleontology are gone for good. Today, archaeological permits require a data plan. For instance, the U.S. National Science Foundation grants for archaeology require a specific data plan for storage of artifacts and data in secure repositories. Software data systems like TDAR provide tools for such documentation. Mongolia is in the position to do so as well, having enacted laws establishing a national artifact registry in 1994 and a more rigorous inventory law in 2014. It established a cultural heritage center with responsibilities to create a central registry of tangible and intangible properties and has developed mechanisms to accomplish this goal. But in a small country, even in a small country with rather modest collections and site inventories, the goal has been elusive due to lack of resources and reluctance of cultural organizations to share records and subscribe to a single documentation system. The obstacles to implementing archaeological data management in any country are daunting and are doubly so in Mongolia. Among the challenges for Mongolia are, one, rapid economic development from tourism, mining, and agricultural industries; two, relatively small cultural resource management and archaeological research capabilities; three, the rapid growth of mandatory archaeological recovery; four, lack of budgetary trickle-down to the heritage sector; five, time-consuming processing of digital and digital archival data; failure of foreign research projects to fully return data and collections; and scarcity of skilled conservators; and finally, increased need for data security and issues of ownership, intellectual property rights, and copyright. In December 2012, Smithsonian experts participated in a Mongolian convocation of cultural leaders called by then Cultural Minister Oyungarol Tsavdamba, explored these issues and urged the government to take a proactive stance to strengthen Mongolia's cultural laws. The following year, the T-Batar issue highlighted the needs for increased regulation, and new law dealing with paleontology and archaeological materials was passed. That same year, the ACMS began a series of workshops on archaeological site and object data management and conservation after we discovered that the famous Ulan Tolgoy and Ushgin Uver deerstone sites had been ravaged. The government was responsive, and when we visited the sites in 2014, a fence had been erected and facilities and information for visitors had been established. But this was only one or two sites out of hundreds without protection. The Mongolian government had earlier taken the important step of establishing the Cultural Heritage Center as the central repository for archaeological data, and this institution has made important strides, supplying cultural organizations with formats and instructions for data submission, both for site inventories and object data. However, the goal was difficult to achieve when many archaeological institutions, like the Institute of Archaeology and the National University and others, were not part of the Ministry of Culture and had no requirement to comply, especially when no new funds were available. The Cultural Heritage Program was a step in the right direction, but did not solve the problem. Subsequently, the Heritage Center has begun its own national archaeological survey, sending teams of archaeologists to inventory sites, many of which had been studied by institutions that do not have the resources or capability to retrieve existing data from their files. The ACMS workshops generated data from Mongolia's regional museums and found consensus about the need for a centralized program of data banking, but exposed many practical problems dealing with financing and equipment. The first workshop focused on the archaeological management problems of the central government agencies and how their data might be made available to the central repository. Representatives of the relevant groups were present, and while agreement in principle was unanimous, the means for achieving the goals were not available. During these meetings, the Smithsonian offered to help implement a documentation system called CIDORA. Unlike typical data banking programs like TDAR, CIDORA has the larger purpose of serving as a full-scale archaeological information system designed to support archaeological research from the field to the laboratory, analysis, and publication. ACMS and Smithsonian activities have helped encourage collaboration and interinstitutional sharing of archaeological data among researchers and agencies in Mongolia. Our workshop partners urged the government to establish a national committee for archaeological data preservation and management to develop standards, security, and access rules. Such a committee would parallel the existing highly effective archaeological permit committee. We're now implementing a pilot program using the CIDORA system for the return of Smithsonian Deerstone, OVO inventories, and Altai rock art data. The larger problem for Mongolia is to solve the crisis of archaeological and heritage preservation, both of sites and existing archives and collections. At present, most cultural institutions do not have the funds or staff to provide information on their research or collection inventories to the existing heritage center data and site registries. Infrastructure deficiencies include primitive storage and security conditions at the Archaeological Institute, Mongolian National Museum, and National University. All cultural institutions in Mongolia agree that more must be done to systematize present chaotic practices, but all partners also agree that nothing can be done without more resources and staffing. The most promising, the least expensive, and administratively neutral proposal is the establishment of a National Committee for Data Management and Conservation. Such a group would resolve differences between agencies and chart best practices. At very least, even without new resources, it would serve as a forum for discussion for institutions and would highlight a problem that is only going to get worse as archaeological collections grow and sites and monuments are subjected to more damage or destruction. Finally, with the support of the Henry Luce Foundation, the ACMS has initiated a Mongolian Cultural Heritage Program based in the ACMS office in Ulaanbaatar. The program includes ACMS Heritage Fellowship Program for 4 to 5 scholars, which has two goals each year, to improve the knowledge about Mongolia's tangible and intangible cultural heritage and to increase knowledge and access of this information. The application period is currently open. Fellows will contribute to the development of data management systems and collections of Mongolia cultural heritage, either with their own research material or with existing collections and archive data in Mongolian institutions. Data generated will be shared with the Mongolian Cultural Heritage Center. Projects may include archival studies, archaeology, language and literature, performing arts, history, religious studies, and others. Social science, natural science, and information technology programs. Projects will also be supported if they have a strong cultural element or application to cultural heritage issues. Scholars will have the opportunity to work with ACMS partners and will be expected to spend some time working directly on cultural heritage project initiatives such as workshops, conferences, and data management projects. Other ACMS heritage projects include barcoding and improved inventory systems for Mongolia museums and archives, development of an association of cultural heritage stakeholders, and close coordination with existing programs of the Mongolia Cultural Heritage Center. We hope these initiatives will help ensure that Mongolian heritage will still be recognizable 50 or 500 years from now. After all, nations, empires, and cities have crumbled, and still the Mongolian herding way of life survived since its inception in the early Bronze Age, about 4,000 years ago. So I would like to just sort of quickly go through a few slides that show you something more about our Deerstone work. Here are our partner partners that we've been working with, and we thank them all, both Mongolian and US. This is just a shot of one of the excavations going on, and the Deerstone sites were studied very carefully by Volkov and Novgorodova in the 60s, 50s and 60s, published a wonderful book documenting quite a lot of the material, but conducting very few excavations. Mostly it was an analysis of the art on the Deerstones. And the dating of the sites was based on comparisons with the typological implements seen on the Deerstones with things that had been excavated in Russia. And as it turned out, that dating was quite a bit later than people thought, because it was assumed partly that the art on the Deerstones was a Scythian Saka period art. So we took a different approach, and we began digging not at the Deerstones, which actually have no bodies near them, no datable materials, But around the deer stones, there are these clusters of rocks. You've probably all seen them. No one really knew too much about what they were, and so we decided to start working in the surrounding areas. And we found that each one of these little clusters of rocks had a horse head. You can see in the slide on the right-hand side the horse head, the neck vertebra, and four hooves in a tight little package with the horse head always facing east. And in these little burials of sacrificed horses just would surround a deer stone. You see three or four or five of them around this one deer stone at Ulan Tolgoy, always with only the sacrificed horse bundles in them. And we radiocarbon dated the horses, and we found that they came to almost the same dates. They all could and probably were contemporaneous. And so we realized that we're dealing here with a sacrifice system that had to do with the implantation of the deer stone, the erection of the stone, people coming together, and important people sacrificing horses, putting them in the ground in a specific ritual. And outside the circles where we found the horse heads, we found circles of hearths which contained burned remains of goats and sheep, sometimes horses and other animals, which were probably also sacrificial meals at the time of this celebration around a deer stone. The dates here conform. They're very, very similar. The chronology is on the early end, around 3,000 years ago, whereas the Pazaric and Saka dates are all in this period, 2400 to 2200, or maybe as early as 2600. So a very clear separation and very clear indication that the art on the deer stones preceded the Scythian and the Saka art period. And exactly the same thing was happening at the Herixors. You see all these clusters of rocks. These are all horse heads under here, and they surround the Herixors, and they're always on the east side of the Herixor, and they always have east-facing horse heads identical to the Deerstone monument ritual. So they very closely agree. It used to be the thought that the deer stones and the Herixors were dating to different time periods and that the Herixors were not burials. Every one of the Herixors is a burial, and only one single person in them. Here's one of the square Herixors. Here's one in the Hanoi Valley, where there is 1,700 horse heads buried around a mound. That's a lot of horses. So this is a pretty serious social operation that's going on. And you found that, you know, in the outlying districts, like way up in Hovsgol, you'd have a few. As you came down to the big valleys, you just get these huge sites with many, many horse heads, huge ceremonies, all put in at the exact same time. The radiocarbon dates from the outermost horse heads are exactly the same as the ones right up next to the Herixor. So very big events back in those days, and obviously a huge social structure, pre-empire, but really almost state formation kind of processes. Here's what those horse burials look like. And so we dug around in different places, not just in those, and we found out there were sacrificial areas over here, a big boulder field with a lot of animal bones where they butchered animals and prepared them for burials and ritual relating to the stones. Very few artifacts are found in any of these situations, unlike the later Pazaric and square burial time period, but this is the kind of bronze that was present and fueling the big trade systems and hierarchies that developed. The deer stones are just spectacular art, spectacular technology, and they've done some wonderful work on a number of these sites. The Mongolian Museum has had a great project excavating one of them near the big Hanoi Valley site. Here's the Scythian burial guys, so you know we're pretty sure that these deer stones are actually individuals, that they have different tools. Each deer stone has a unique set of tools and belt patterns and deer on the torso. And we think that these probably are actually the representations of the tattooed bodies and the tools of very important leaders, sometimes shamans, sometimes political leaders, maybe both. And this is a deer stone that is a very interesting one. We found a few years ago, which is kind of transitional between the Deerstone period and the Saka Scythian period. And we lose the structure that you see on the classic deer stones, and you get a lot of animal confrontations, which are definitely Scythian Saka style art and philosophy, in addition to the iconic Mongolian deer and tools that are not always attached to a belt and so forth. So this is a really interesting one. Unfortunately, we were unable to get a radiocarbon date for the stone. And so it's a very interesting, you know, it's a transitional situation. And I think it's really fascinating to think that Mongolia actually has some of these precursors of the Scythian art that no one really knew about. It was always assumed that the influence was flowing the other way, and the Mongolia was the recipient of this stuff. And now we know that it's very early, and it may not be the exact forerunners of Scythian and Saka, but it was participating in a style system that was developing at that time, and it is so far the earliest representation of these types of art. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. A wonderful talk. It really goes so well with the talk we had a couple of weeks ago from Esther Jacobson Tepfer, also talking about rock art, but in the western part of Mongolia. So with that, we've concluded our first panel with a slight delay of the overnight, and we're going to move on to our second panel, which is going to be chaired by Brian Bauman.
Our second panel is in two parts. And this will be the first part, and my colleague Frank Bilic will chair the second part. Our panel is Mining Water and the Steppes Under Stress. Let's see, should I? We have three speakers with us. The first one is Dr. Amy Hessl. Dr. Hessl is a professor in the Department of Geology and Geography at Almost Heaven, West Virginia University. You probably get that a lot. Yeah. Anyway, her work focuses on the impact of human institutions upon the environment, and she'll be speaking to us on past, current, and future drought in Mongolia.
So it's a real pleasure to be here today. I was actually an undergraduate student here long ago, so it's kind of neat to come back to your alma mater and get invited to give a talk. So I'm going to be talking today about some work that I've been doing in Mongolia with a host of other people. It's taken about 10 years to pull it together and a lot of collaborators. Only some of them are listed here. We're also supported every field season by many undergraduate students from the National University of Mongolia in the forestry program there, and we're very appreciative of their assistance. So I think I'm speaking to a knowing audience here that Mongolia has experienced many social and environmental changes over the last several decades. This is a image from Google Earth looking at the outskirts of Ulaanbaatar and noting some of the urbanization that's happened just in the last couple decades. It's quite remarkable, and I think is potentially something we might be seeing in other semi-arid regions of the world in coming decades. So I think in many ways what's happened in Mongolia over the last several years is something that the rest of the world should probably be paying attention to closely. For those of you who don't know, many of the settlements on the outskirts of Ulaanbaatar are informal settlements without running water or electricity, so they have a whole host of environmental problems that come along with that, and we're going to be hearing in greater detail about that in the next few hours. So I'm very excited to hear about what's happening on that research front. But on the steppe, there's also been major changes that have happened, and there's a lot of controversy and not a lot of understanding about whether those changes are caused by social and economic effects following the fall of the Soviet influence and the rise of the market economy, or whether those changes on the steppe are a function of changes in climate, or both features could certainly be responsible for that. So here's just two papers that I selected that have come out in the last year looking at whether Mongolia's rangelands are at a tipping point, looking at biomass change, whether overgrazing is decimating Mongolian steppe. And so what's the context for this? How much of this is caused by opening of markets and changing of herd dynamics and herd composition, and how much of it is caused by climate change? At the same time, there was a paper in 2014 that looked at the rapid loss of lakes on the Mongolian plateau, so not just Mongolia, but China's Mongolia as well. And so on the right hand, or on your left hand side here, where you have a one-to-one line there, you would expect lakes to be staying at the same size between the 1980s on the x-axis there and the 2010 on the y-axis. Any dot that's dropped below that line is a lake that's shrunk in size. And Inner Mongolia is in red, and the country of Mongolia is in blue there. So both countries have both regions have experienced major lake loss. On the right is a bit of research that one of my colleagues did in the central part of Mongolia in the Orkhon Valley, where we've seen about 35% lake loss in lake, so 35% reduction in lake area in central Mongolia from 1995 to present. So a major loss of lakes, which if you're a herder, that's a big deal for you. And it's, I think, signals something about a changing environment. So this caused us to look at drought over Asia and particularly over Mongolia between 2000 and 2011. And so this is a map on your left here is an index called the Palmer Drought Severity Index. This is a measure of soil moisture, so it takes into account both temperature and precipitation, which is something I think that's really important. And so if there's anything that you take home from my talk today, is that when we look at forecasts of changes in precipitation and changes in temperature in Mongolia, those things should not be examined separately. We need to think about those things together. And you can imagine that if Mongolia is a giant evaporative dish, what are the things that matter? You know, so it's temperature, how much precipitation, wind speed, humidity, all those things matter. And all of those things are part of this measure of drought severity, so the Palmer Drought Severity Index. And so where it's red, we see between 2000 and 2011, we have much drier conditions than during the historical climatological average. And so what's interesting is Mongolia is mostly red during this period, but there's also some things happening in monsoon Asia at the same time. And we know based on some work by Ed Cook and others at Columbia University that these kinds of events, these extreme droughts that happen over Asia and have these interesting parallels with monsoon failure, those kinds of droughts have happened in the past, prehistoric period. But what's unique about the current drought is that it's happening under these elevated temperatures. So if you look on the right there, I've plotted warm season temperatures. So that's June, July, August, and September. And comparing this drought period from 2000 to 2011 to the climatological record. And what we see is that during this recent decade, we have temperatures about 1.5 degrees C above the long-term average. Now, that's an interesting number because temperatures like that are thrown around as we've seen maybe 2 degrees C change total in Mongolia since the 1940s. We might see another 2 to 2.5 or maybe 4 degrees C change in the next 100 years in Mongolia. So what do those temperatures really mean in terms of affecting productivity, grassland productivity, and the ability for this beautiful pastoral system that we've seen in Mongolia, as the previous speaker just mentioned, for 4,000 years, what does that mean in terms of the ability of herders to continue to do what they do well in Mongolia? So here's just a further example of this importance of combining both precipitation and temperature in our mindset of how we can expect future climate change to impact Mongolia. So on the x-axis is precipitation, on the y-axis is temperature, and the years of that recent drought are highlighted there with their numbers. And so you can see that during that time period, it was dry, although not every year was exceptionally dry in terms of precipitation, but it was always during a time of elevated temperature. So what I'd like to do today is use some of the tools that I use as a scientist, which is an interesting set of tools, to ask questions about the context of this drought. So how unusual was this drought during the last 2,000 years? And what does that tell us about what we might expect to see in future decades in Mongolia? And hopefully, this might spur a conversation about how people can be resilient or what kinds of actions might need to be taken to deal with these future moisture conditions in Mongolia. And the question, though, is how do you do this? And what I really need is a time machine. If I had a time machine, I could go back in time and see how unusual these conditions are. Well, this one didn't really work for me, so I thought maybe this one might work. But no, this is my time machine. So I use the rings of trees. There are environmental archives that can tell us about past climate conditions in many places in the world. They work exceptionally well in Mongolia, where trees are drought stressed no matter where they are in the country. But in certain places in Mongolia, the trees are exceptionally drought stressed and they're exceptionally long lived. And so in those places, we can build a beautiful record of past moisture conditions. Now, trees are biological organisms, so they're not rain gauges, right? But they do respond to the same kinds of environmental features that pastoralists might be interested in. So trees are responding to both soil moisture, they're responding to humidity, they're responding to air temperature. So all those factors are important for them. So in a way, they're like a beautiful naturalistic recorder of past environmental conditions. So this is a cross-section of a tree that we found, or of a log that we found on a lava flow in central Mongolia, and its inner ring date is in the 600s. So a lot of you might know that you can, you know, with a live tree, you could count backwards the rings and get back to the first year that the tree established, and then you could use the widths of those rings to tell you something about what moisture conditions were like. But how do you go back further than the age of the living tree? So what we do is we build what we call a long, very well-replicated chronology. So we collect lots of samples from living trees. Here's an example of a tree. We take a tiny core from the live tree, and this one dated from 1530 to when we cored it in 2013. And then we start looking for logs of trees that are on the ground that were alive during the same time as the living trees, and we find patterns in the ring widths that are similar, so meaning the trees were alive and experiencing the same environmental conditions at the same time. And then we keep pushing that record further back in time. So this tree was alive from 890 to 1572. And we keep collecting more and more samples. So for each site, we have hundreds of samples. And so we have a very well-replicated record. This is one we just sampled last June. So we're getting down to like the end point of what you can do with these logs from this lava flow. So this is, we don't have this one dated yet, but we just take small sections of this wood and we look for a pattern match with a tree that we already have dated. We also have a new method for confirming our dates, actually. So there were a few pulsars that happened in the 700s and 900s that are accurately dated to the year. And so we can actually look at the carbon-14 information from the rings and confirm that we actually have things dated to the year going back to 700 and 900s. So that's kind of a cool new trick we have. Okay, so what we end up with is a long record going back in time. I'm just showing you from zero to 2011, but we actually have data going back about 2,700 years. But right now, this is what we're confident with. So we have enough replication, and we have it accurately dated back to, it's actually negative 49. It's a really strong record with the instrumental Palmer Drought Severity Index, so the measure from the instrumental data of drought. And you can see that in the upper left panel there. Our record from tree rings accounts for about 72% of the variability in the instrumental record, which is really astounding for something that's not a rain gauge. You know, these are just trees growing on rocks. They're very thirsty, but they're really phenomenal at recording past climate conditions. So the black line is the instrumental and the red line is the tree ring record. On the right, it shows you a representation of what kind of area the two sites that we've been collecting from, what kind of area they represent. So those are significant correlations with the Palmer Drought Severity Index in anything that's in red. So it's showing us that those, just from those two sites, we can really say quite a bit about most of central Mongolia and maybe even into parts of China about what the moisture conditions were like in the past. Now, I know when you look at this long record like this, it's really hard to pick out any individual events. So I'm going to try and help you a little bit here. This is one of the most severe droughts that we see in the record is in the early 800s. And this is actually interesting if you're familiar with some of the earlier empires in Mongolia. So this is happening during the time of the Uyghur Empire. And it was an exceptional drought that actually followed a fairly wet period before that. There's another exceptional drought that happened in the late 1100s, and we've already published a little bit about this. So this was a really dry period that preceded the rise of the Mongol Empire, and it's actually somewhat represented in the historical documents about sort of tribal warfare and sort of internecine warfare on the steppe during that time that just precedes what we call the Mongol Pluvial, which is right after that. It was an exceptionally wet period in the early 1200s, which I'll show you another representation of that in a minute. And the last thing I want to point out is this recent drought during the 21st century, which is at the tail end of our record. And what we see is the trees barely making it through this period. It was, in fact, one of the most difficult parts of working with our data was just getting started because of the recent growth of the trees was so microscopic that it was really hard to find all the rings in that recent decade. But what's also interesting about this period is it was preceded again by a very wet period in the late 1990s and in the 1950s, exceptionally wet and warm on the plateau. So what does this mean in terms of elevated temperature? Well, I've combined our record here on the top with a record of just reconstructed temperature for the last 1,000 years for Asia. And we can see that not only in the instrumental record do we see this elevated temperature during the last decade or so, but when we compare it to the last 1,000 years of data for Asia, we see that temperatures were exceptionally warm. And so if you go back to the 800s, for example, and you know that we have this exceptional drought during the 800s, it was nowhere near as warm, according to the reconstructed temperature, as it is today. So the current drought may be comparable to the drought in the 800s, but it's operating under much warmer temperatures. Another way to look at this data is rather than looking at it over as like a time series, we can look at it as individual events. And so what we have here is a new kind of analysis I've been working on where I'm trying to estimate how often we would expect to see a drought like the 2000s repeat based on the data that we have. So on the marginal histograms show you how often we have droughts of different lengths and durations. So on the x-axis is the duration of the drought, and on the y-axis is the severity. And so the 2000s drought is nearly approaching the 1,000-year return time. So we wouldn't expect to see another drought like that, you know, only every 1,000 years or so. There's one more extreme drought noted there in the upper right corner. That's the drought that began in 804. So that's the one that's more extreme, although we would argue that it happened under a a cooler temperature. And just as a side note here, that this recent drought has followed a very unusual pluvial period, so a very wet period in the 1990s. I know it's kind of hard to see which dot that was, but it's the one just below 1990 there, and it's also a 1,000-year pluvial. So we're looking at this strange, strange coincidence of events between 1990 and 2011, where you have the wettest decade, and then it's followed by the driest decade nearly that we see in the in our 2,000-year record. Oh, and just if you wanted to know, one of those two dots out there is the what we call the Mongol Pluvial, this really, really wet period under which the Mongol Empire thrived. And we have that published a couple years ago, if you're interested. So now we need to look to the future. So what is this going to mean, these kinds of conditions that we're seeing now, how do those pair up with climate forecasts, thank you, of future conditions? And so what we need is this kind of time machine. We need to go back to the future. And that's much more interesting than if I show you a picture of climate models, right? Like the machines that run the climate models are just like these really boring boxes. But what they produce is amazing, right? Like it's incredible. So if we look to combining our record of the past with forecasts for the future, there's a very interesting story that unfolds. So the black there is our long tree ring reconstruction of moisture conditions. And in the red zone, you have the red line, which is forecasts of future moisture conditions in Mongolia, which seem like, oh, it's kind of flat. It's really not changing too much. But the uncertainties are this trumpet that we see. So we see either you're going to have really, really wet conditions, or you're going to have really, really dry conditions. And that depends on whether moisture gets delivered to Mongolia or not. So right now, the forecasts for climate forecasts for Mongolia suggest that it could get a little bit wetter, but those projections are really uncertain. So what we have is what my friend Kevin Angikaitis has labeled the trumpet of uncertainty. As you go further out into the future, you see this ever-widening forecast of moisture conditions for Mongolia, where we really don't know if they're going to be wetter or drier. What's fascinating is that within the bounds of that trumpet of uncertainty, we have that really, really wet 1990s, as well as that really, really dry 21st century drought. So the forecasts actually are a good envelope of what we've just seen happen in Mongolia. And that suggests to me that our future may very well be one of uncertain conditions. All right, so the take-home message here is that the 21st century drought was exceptionally dry. Its return interval above 900 years, but it followed the wettest decade of the last millennium. And so we have this incredible paradox where we've seen rapid social and economic development happen in Mongolia, exactly coincident with some of the most extreme climatic conditions that have been experienced there over the last 1,000 years, at least. We have medieval droughts that were severe, like the 800s drought, but they occurred under a cooler climate and were driven by different causes. And I guess to conclude, I'd just like to say that future climate in Mongolia may include more extreme drought conditions as temperatures continue to rise. That will just continue to drive evaporative demand. But at the same time, we should also expect some additional decades like the 1990s that were very, very wet. So I'd like to finish there, but I'd just like to thank the National Science Foundation that has supported us on a number of projects in Mongolia, including this one, supported by the Coupled Natural Human Systems Project, or directorate of the National Science Foundation and the National Geographic Society and my university that's also been very supportive over the last decade. Thank you.
Our second speaker is Yuma, Argo, yeah. And Yuma is an environmental health specialist with the Monterey County Health Department. She also works as an interpreter and translator, which is a thankless job, if any of you have done that. She earned a master's degree from Berkeley's own School of Public Health, and she'll be speaking to us today on water resources and policy of Mongolia. So let's welcome Yuma.
Today, I will be presenting my colleague Chulonhui's paper on water resources and policy of Mongolia. And then I will share my perspective on the soil and water pollution in UB. So I'm speaking for Chulonhui when I say that the amount of fresh water in Mongolia is very small, and it is decreasing. in Chulunhuyuk and other water professionals in Mongolia know this is an urgent problem. And I want to share that message with you here today. So the total of water resources in Mongolia is very limited, as I said. That it's this total of water, 599 cubic kilometer is only surface water, and you could see this small number of water. Are you guys hearing me okay? Okay. So since we have very since little water, and then actually we have the water is actually decreasing, and there are specific threats to freshwater ecosystems in Mongolia. So Mongolians actually use the water supply very insufficient, and then also the sanitation is a problem there. And for the threats, the overgrazing is also a problem, and the herders are no longer rotating animals over shared pastures. Since privatization of livestock, there are twice as many pastoral households, resulting in competition, conflict, and overgrazing. They say the next problem is deforestation of watersheds. Vegetation is needed to keep water in the soil, but herders are cutting grasses to feed livestock in the winter. There are also cutting timber for heating and cooking. There are also dams. Dams being built for hydroelectricity are a major threat to freshwater systems in Mongolia. So here, mining and gravel extraction and pollution is also a big problem, but I will not address this serious threat because you'll be hearing about it in another talk. So there are another problem, the institutional problem, because there are many departments actually running about water problems. I mean, about water issues, and I will talk about that later on this slide. So we all know the climate change is a big problem for the water, and then the average temperature has increased 2.1 Celsius lately. And the climate change also impacting on surface water, and there is also evaporation problem, and it says evaporation has increased by 3.2 to 10%. And also there is a challenge on the groundwater resources, and the groundwater resources also decreasing. In the lot of the Mongolians, actually Mongolian drinking water is, they get the drinking water from ground, especially in the countryside. They use wells, and then now the wells are not working well because the groundwater is actually decreasing or going even deep, so they cannot really pump the water now. So that's why all the wells actually not working well in many places. And then this is the impact. Now, you were talked about the drought. I actually, this is a little bit different than my abstract because I just got these numbers last night from Chulunhuyuk, and he sent me this information. So this information he got from a public health department in Mongolia. And then they did some study throughout the country, and then they did a study from 330 small cities and rural area, it's a sum, right? We all know. And they counted, it's very scary numbers showing up. The total counted rivers, it was 6,646. And from here, 551 rivers actually has no water now. And then they also counted water, and then groundwater and wells, and the groundwater, you could see they disappeared, 1,587. The groundwater or wells are not working now. So, and also there is a scary number from lakes and ponds. The 3,130 lakes, ponds have water, but the 483 lakes have no water now. So this is a scary number we have. And also, So this is what I was going to say. This is the study, and then they also did some study on people's health, and then they actually found this number 38 and 5% of the people were sick because of their drinking water. And then they, what kind of diseases they have? It's five major diseases they found. The number one is stomach diseases. Of course, they're not drinking right water, right? And then liver and gallbladder and heart, and they also have a dental problem. We all know this. The country people have dental problems. And so Mongolian government is actually taking some issue, taking this seriously, but they actually created two regulations or two programs working on water, but the water professionals think that's not enough. And then the water professionals in Mongolia recommending, so they need to really reduce the number of ministries and organizations. And they renew the Department of Water and they prioritize national-oriented goals. They really need some centralized goal to issue this problem. And then also there is people paying for their drinking water, but then the calculation methods are not really running right. That's what they think. And then create a national water program. And of course, they really need to establish suitable water policy for the climate change. It's time for them now. So this is their references. And if you have a question, please send him email, because I'm not in this field person. So that's his presentation. And then I would like to say something, since I'm an environmental health specialist, and then I've been working in this field since 1993. And then my area, expertise area is actually indoor and air quality. And then also I work in waste management services in Monterey County Health Department, as he said. So I really want to say something about Mongolian environmental issues. So that's why I included my slides in here. So we all know now we have three major problems: air pollution, water pollution, and soil pollution. This is really going on now. And we did very good study in air pollution. So Kirk Smith is going to present about that. So I don't think I need to talk about air pollution now. So I really see, I think, the city groundwater is polluting. I have to change the error, actually. It's actually polluting from the wastewater and also solid and liquid waste. From the households. You'll see this water is actually, it's illegal, we know, but this is happening once in a while in the summertime or winter. This is wastewater from the city, from the buildings, and then actually dumping into the city river. And this is Lambater. This is the city, if you see that from far away. And the city of Lambater have a soil so pollution problem, I think. If you go everywhere in the Gir district, even in the city, we see this trash everywhere. And then people can just discard their trash just outside of their household or fence. And then my concern is people walk, you know, go to work and come back. They walk on their trash and go to their house and then walk with their shoes. And then kids play on the floor, and then so many people get sick, and then they have to go to hospital and pay for medicine. It's bad for economic, and then, you know, we can talk a lot about that. The second, the next is we have only river running. I mean, it's the major river running in the city, but we see that, and then when you go from the airport, you'll see this trash everywhere. It's actually polluting the soil and the water. So this is typical Gir district in households. So this is during winter, and people just dump their wastewater just outside of their household. This is the stomach disease, wherever the bacteria is growing. I mean, winter is fine, and then summer, we'll see. But this is not only this area, it's everywhere also, I can say that. It's not only Gir district, it's also in a residential area and apartment buildings. People, some area, of course, nice and clean, but this most areas, like this area, my mom lives there. And this trash is just very typical. So this is, of course, it's bad. And then why do we have these problems? This is my opinion. We really need to have a good study on water pollution. And then actually the city should have good water professionals. I mean, I think do we have enough water professionals, but they need to work on that. And then in my opinion, really need to update the regulations on water. So that's, the city should have strong rules for this, the problems. So how to resolve these problems? Because I'm working in America now in the county, and then I actually work in solid waste management program. Right now I'm working on medical waste, and then I also work in solid waste program, and then how they handle their trash. I've seen it, how Americans really handling it. How about Mongolians? Actually, they're actually doing some landfills now, and I guess they're working on it. So I think there need more studies on our water sources, and then prepare professionals, and then hire them in ministries. Really should hire professionals. And then I always think about the sandwich program. So we have graduate students in Mongolia, like master's students and PhD students. Why not the government pay for them while they're studying in Mongolia? They can come here, study for 2 semesters, you know, just to get some, catch up all this latest information, and then back to Mongolia, graduate there, they could share their knowledge in Mongolia. That's what I always think about that. It doesn't have to be US, of course. I just put it US. So I've seen from this, from my job, I really think Mongolians need the private waste management companies. So that way, the private waste management companies really can manage that solid waste problem. And then I think once there is a private waste management companies, government really should fund those companies. That's what I think. So I see here, state really funds the private companies. And then at the end, the education, really the people who live in Gair district, even in the whole city, we need to educate our people. You can't really dump your trash or disregard your trash or wastewater outside of your household. And you actually walk on there. So that's what I think we really should do this. And thank you.
Oh, okay. Our third and final speaker in this first part of the second panel is Dr. Sara Jackson. Sara is a lecturer at the Metropolitan State University of Denver's Earth and Atmospheric Science Department. Is that right? So she studies the politics and consequences of resource extraction in Mongolia. And among her publications, she has an article that I've actually read. I happened upon it one day, just roaming Google Scholar, and the title of it is Dusty Roads and Disconnections, Perceptions of Dust from Unpaved Mining Roads in Mongolia's South Gobi Province. And having been born and raised on a farm in North Dakota, dust is nostalgic for me. So I couldn't. And some of you might remember that there's a wrestler, the wrestler Dusty Rhodes, remember him? Yeah. Anyway, that's all.
What did my high school name after that
guy? Oh, really? Yeah. Anyway, that's beside the point. But Sara will be speaking on will there be any water left to pollute? Perceptions of mining water infrastructure and changing visions of land use in Umgove. So let's welcome her.
Hello, thank you, Brian, for the warm introduction. And thank you for inviting me to this symposium conference. I'm very excited to be here and very glad to be following two speakers whose work relates very closely, I think, to what I'm going to be talking about. So I'm going to be talking about pressures on water resources in Ungo, specifically in Hongbok, Tsum, where Oyutogoi is located. Just to give you a little background, for the last 5 or 6 years, that's where I've been doing my research, my PhD research, specifically on Oyutogoi and in some of the surrounding Tsums as well, but especially in Hongbok, and looking at infrastructure. Water infrastructure, road infrastructure, and this was particularly during the construction phase when I was doing most of my research. And of course, I'm sure many of you are familiar with some of the development promises of Oyutogoi, as well as some of their promises of bringing better in, mining standards to Mongolia, more sustainable methods, international standards, this kind of discourse. So I have focused quite a bit on water infrastructure, but mostly on sort of perceptions of scarcity. And water pollution hasn't really been much of a focus, but when I saw the call for papers, I said, oh, I have to talk about pollution. I better figure out how to do that, because nobody ever really talks about it when I've talked to people in the area. And so just to give a little bit of background in terms of issues of water scarcity in Hongbok, of course, we're talking about in the Gobi. And generally, precipitation is from May to September. Heaviest precipitation, about 80 millimeters, 270 millimeters per year, compared to San Francisco, which has about 600 millimeters per year. And of course, we have, you know, there are ephemeral streams. This is the Undangol, south of Oyutogoi. And then, of course, the high loss, the Siberian elm, is some of the more dramatic vegetation in the area. So I hear, when I'm talking to herders, these are just some quotes of kind of the typical things that I hear. So the water is reducing every year. There's almost no water on the ground surface. So there is no rain. If you don't have moisture in the soil, where does the rain come from, right? Or here's another example. In recent years, the Gobi hasn't had much rain. Now rain is very scarce. When I was a child, there was a lot of rain, and now there is very little. Another one. We also used to have surface waters around here during three seasons of a year, spring, summer, and fall. In winter, surface waters freeze. Animals drank from the surface waters. Now we don't have surface waters anymore. They dried up. As the surface waters dry up, the well waters decrease. And then here's a final one. The groundwater is drying out. Our well had enough water for 200 camels, but now it has water for only 20 camels. If there is no water, it is impossible to herd animals. Pasture is running out, and it will be impossible to increase the number of animals. So there's generally this sense in Hongbok of this major pressure on water, that people are having to decrease their herd size, in addition to pressures on pasture. So example for in what I write about in the article on dust, that people aren't sure about their future because of this lack of water. And oftentimes, people attribute it to mining infrastructure, but also recognizing that climate change is playing a role as well. So how do I talk about pollution in this context of water scarcity? So drawing on the hydrosocial cycle idea, popular in the political ecology of water literature, to think about this sort of co-production of discursive and material processes, the idea that water and society are mutually constitutive and sort of shaping each other. So I'm going to talk a little bit about relationships between scarcity and pollution in terms of visibility and invisibility of pollution in these cycles. And to talk about not only about biophysical processes and mining effects, but also how people talk about these processes. And infrastructure that's directing water flows, and also who has the power to produce and control knowledge about water resources. So just to give you some examples of some types of water quality issues that people have talked to me about, first of all, there is the issue of arsenic in the water. that is naturally occurring. According to the WHO, the levels of arsenic in, according to Purevdorj 2012, the wells in the area have twice the WHO acceptable level of arsenic. And this is a natural occurrence, again, which, though, can lead to cancer, skin lesions, neurotoxin. It's a neurotoxin, caused problems with diabetes, heart disease, and, of course, children's development. And then also, people in Hongbogd and the surrounding area talk about water having hojerte, not hojerte, but hojerte. I can only make that joke to so many audiences, so I thought I'd take advantage of the opportunity. So hojerte water, right? Water with salt and minerals in it. And people, here's a picture, I think this is a farm in Bayanovo, where obviously you can see the salt in the earth. From the evaporation, but then people also talk about their hands being covered in salt after they wash their hands, or their pots being ringed with the white film, and that's just from natural minerals in the water. And of course, there's other things, more serious issues like kidney stones and so forth. And of course, there's also been research on livestock near wells and what kind of contaminants, biological contaminants, from that goat taking a little bath in the trough there. So there's also, though, more we can talk about the human factor. So this is just a chart showing the population increases in Ungol, Imag, in the blue line, and then Hongbogd, the red. So basically, there was almost 100% increase of population during the construction of Oyo Tolgoi in Hongbogd, especially from 2010 to about 2013, major increase in population. And a lot of people talk about population increasing as being a source of pressure, of course, on water resources in terms of the quantity, but also in terms of the quality. So and that also can be attributed to trash. So an OT worker told me that the environment is polluted not only from OT. When people build homes, they go to the river to dig stones and sand. They must also be a reason if the river stops flowing, it can't be clean. When we go to the river, we see lots of waste, alcohol bottles, cigarette waste, women's tampons, sanitary napkins. So there's this major theme of contaminants coming from people moving into the area that is tied to mining, but not exactly mining pollution, but just that extra waste and pollution that having more people brings to the area. So there's also the reuse of mining equipment for domestic uses, or sort of, well, this is an example from, this is actually from last May, so a little more recent, that there's been a lot of, there was until last summer, a major drought happening. And this is a water container that was given to a herder by, he said, by Oyu Tolgoi in November 2014 in order to make up for water shortages. When I was there in May, people were having tremendous problem getting any water. All the wells were drying up, even in the Zadgai and the ephemeral streams. They weren't able to dig wells and get any water. It was a really major problem. So this was a container that the herder had been given, but he had been shearing his sheep that week, and he noticed red lesions developing on the camels, and he attributed this to the water. So it was this idea that this water container that, you know, was not natural was causing this problem for his camels that he had just noticed because he had just shorn his sheep, or shorn his camels, excuse me. So another, though, to go back to mining more specifically, I want to talk a little bit about Oyo Tolgoi's tailings dams. So because of the climate, generally Oyo Tolgoi is considered lower risk in terms of your tailings dams, not likely to have major significant water flows that are going to cause problems like we saw in Brazil last year in Bento Rodriguez. And so here's just a Landsat image of Oyo Tolgoi's tailings dam. And you can see right? There is some water in that tailings dam. And so their dam design is a conventional thickened tailings paste in a clay-lined dam, and it's at surface grade, so it's just put at the surface. And it's about 60 to 65% solids at discharge, and it's not a covered dam. It's an uncovered dam. And so the majority of the mine's water loss is actually coming from that evaporation from the tailings dam. It's about 80%. But in an analysis of best practices of tailings dam by Paul Robinson with the Southwest Research and Information Center, someone who I do analysis with from time to time, he argues that there could be a level above what Oyu Tolgoi has been doing and should be doing. So he argues for dry tailings dams at 70% or more solids, and that the construction of the dam should really be below grade so that you prevent even more so any problems with flooding that you could possibly have or the dam breaking. And he also suggests multiple small tailings dams or tailings storage facilities as well as covering the dam. And the reason to cover is, of course, then you minimize evaporation so you can recover more of that water, because that's a big part of Oyu Tolgoi's recycling program, is to recover that water that rises to the top as the solid sink in the tailings dam. Also, you're going to prevent water infiltration from precipitation. Of course, there isn't a lot of precipitation in the area, but if you covered it, you would be limiting that infiltration of precipitation, limiting water intrusion, and therefore further limiting the possibility of the oxidized minerals mixing with water to cause acid mine drainage. And of course, you have less water, you're using less material, you need less space, so there's less land degradation happening. And then there's less that you have to do when you have to rehabilitate the mine. So the cost of a dry tailings dam is higher, but there's more long-term protection. And consultants had recommended that OT pursue a tailings design with a paste of 70% solids, but they considered the operating and capital costs too high compared to what the water savings would be. So they did not go with the best practices in this case, which would have saved them water and even further limited any potential issues with water pollution. So overall, there's been other critiques of Oyu Tolgoi's tailings dams, including lack of detailed plans. In general, they released their complete environmental social impact assessment after they had finished much of the construction, so there wasn't really any point to the public consultations because a lot of the work had already been done. And then there's, of course, the question of the ownership of the mine and the renewing of Rio Tinto's operation of the mine in the coming decades, and who will manage the tailings, who will manage the reclamation process, if it becomes Mongolia's responsibility in the end to make sure that happens. So with pollution and Oyu Tolgoi, it is a lot of ifs. I mean, if we talk about road dust, that's another question. but with water, it's a lot of ifs. It really depends on issues related to the climate and the upkeep of the mine. How do we think about water pollution within the broader context of pressure on water resources? So we can talk about climate change variability, which other panelists have spoken very eloquently about. More sporadic precipitation, heavier rainfall is a lot of what people report. These issues of compacting the soil, decreasing soil penetration depths, and of course, pasture degradation leading to more dust, all related to water. And of course, that has some pollution effects as well. And then of course, we have the naturally high mineral concentrations in existing water resources. And then also this issue of increasing populations, what to do with industrial and human waste in these areas of mining that don't have a lot of infrastructure for growing populations. There's also the discussion of the Orkhon River diversion, and what does that mean not only for the Gobi, but also for the Slang up into Lake Baikal, and what are the environmental costs of that project is a big question if that does go through, which is very controversial. And then also there are the changes in the water laws, which maybe just as an academic, I'm being selfish for bringing this one up. But the new water laws state it is prohibited for foreign citizens, sorry, I've got an S there, entities and organizations to conduct hydrology and water body related research and surveys at water fund areas without the permission of the state central organization in charge of nature and the environment. So I think there's reasons for restricting the research by foreigners is understandable for national security and control over resources and information, but it does prevent challenges for independent analyses and outside funding for independent research. And then also something to consider is how this new law affects the hydrosocial cycle. So we have changing power over knowledge of water and the state consolidating this power. And I'm not saying this is good or bad necessarily, just something for us as researchers who are interested in water issues to consider. So just to conclude, I think this the model of the hydrosocial cycle is very useful, I think, for framing relationships between biophysical processes, discourse, and politics, and infrastructure as well. And I think it's important to consider how scarcity and water pollution are co-produced both materially and discursively, and then also how these discourses of water scarcity may in fact be obfuscating potential pollution issues because we're focusing so much on scarcity and not thinking about pollution. At the same time, recognizing, right, they're connected. And also that mining companies, the state, local herders, everyone are tied together through these different processes. So I have a few select references, and thank you, and I apologize to all the Canadians in the room. I forgot to add the Canadian Social Science and Humanities Research Council on my funders list. So anyways, thank you very much for your time.
I'll just say one thing. This problem of pollution in the non-modern world is a subject of the fall of man. And in Buddhist tradition, there's a text called The Elucidation of the Knowable that Pakpa Lama wrote for Kublai Khan's son, Denjin, True Gold. And in it, there's this story of the fall of man. In ages past, human beings lived as gods in the sky, in heaven, and everything they did was wonderful and great. But the foods that they ate were a little bit tainted, a little bit impure, but they were very delicious. And the more they ate, the more impure they became, and they fell to earth. And from that point forward, everything they touch becomes impure. And this is the world of Mahasamadha and agriculture. And if any of you know agriculture or know any farmers, you'll know that, or have a garden, everything you touch is affected in some way by what you do. There's a kind of impurity that comes into all of our actions on the earth. With that, there's an old prayer to have the strength to change the things that you can change, to have the forbearance to leave alone the things you can't change, and the wisdom to know the difference. And with that, we'll open this up for questions. So, Alicia.
I have a comment and then I have a question. The first comment is related to the fact that Mongolia has below freezing temperatures 7 months of the year. This is not the ideal place that people would choose. They could choose all the places in the world to live where they live. And that also explains Mongolia's low population all the centuries.
So in effect, what I'm also saying is that when we talk about global warming in Mongolia, from certain points of view, this is not a bad thing in terms of human habitation or plant, vegetable life, or animal life. But one of the things that I want to relate this panel's discussion in terms of water resources. Because Mongolia has such an extreme continental climate, it also has a very strong and limiting permafrost situation. And that permafrost is also in the Gobi. So when we're talking about the warming that's taking place and the evaporation, which of course is losing some of the water resources, my question is, it seems logical that we also have a permafrost which is slowly melting, and that in effect would have some very beneficial effects, especially for the kinds of vegetation, trees that can be living in places where before perhaps they couldn't live because the root system would not go through the permafrost. I also know that for the plateau of Mongolia, basically tilts north to south with the water resources between the land that's not under permafrost and the permafrost layer, we have water going, table of water going basically down towards Inner Mongolia and China. And this is one of the reasons for national security. Mongolia looks at this water situation, and also why China is worried about what happens in Mongolia. But so when you look at where the negatives are, which is evaporation and the higher temperatures, is anyone knowledgeable or could comment on possible positives in the climatic situation?
I can't answer for that because I just presented for my colleague's paper, so you can send an email about your comment. I can give you his contact information.
I have one comment related to that, which is that it appears that during this warm, wet, late 20th century and 1950s to 1990s period, there was quite a bit of increase in agriculture that happened in Mongolia and continues to happen, particularly in the northern part, like along the Selang. So it's possible that, you know, that's a real benefit, but it has to be, you know, organized, and there has to be water to support that. And it's just a different livelihood than what we've seen there for a really long time. So it's not necessarily a good or bad thing, but it's a pretty rapid change. And whether or not the range of variability that we expect to see in moisture conditions can support agriculture year after year, it's going to require a different kind of infrastructure than what's been there before.
I mean, I haven't heard anyone... Oh, oops. Push, oh, there, that's on. Okay. Sorry. I haven't heard anyone talk about permafrost, but I mean, in the Gobi where I work, I mean, there's just a limit of space and water. So I don't know, maybe if they do divert the Orkhon, they could start growing more down there. But I don't know if that's something anyone wants to see. So.
Well, I know quite a bit about this because this is connected to the airport. Mm hmm.
There isn't very much down there. Most of it's up north.
Yeah.
It will get down when you have them in mountains. But the other thing about permafrost is, and the reason they talk about it thawing rather than melting, is because there's a lot of dry permafrost, no water.
Did you work with Cholohoyuk? He was saying, did you work with the Cholohoyuk? I'm just asking you. Cholohoyuk, the one I just presented, the paperwork.
No,
you.
Oh,
okay.
He's done all of our work.
Oh, okay.
Up north. But it's pretty well, it's published a lot of that earlier work that the Russians did.
They had a whole permafrost institute.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Exactly. They know it very well. But, you know, it's a good point, but I don't think there's very much water there. It's groundwater that you're really after.
Yeah, I'll tell you something about this.
Yeah, but one thing to know, of course, is that once you have a rainstorm, and if it goes down to the level of permafrost, it's stuck there. It won't freeze very much, but then it can, if you've got the bedrock, or if there's any slant downward, that rainwater will flow off. So you're not really seeing permafrost thaw and water coming out of it, because in fact, the permafrost thaw rate is very, very slow.
And in the meantime, maybe we can change this one and have another question or two, if that's possible. We'll get back to this one. Any other questions?
It's such a short question. I'm not sure it needs a microphone, but I just had a question for Amy. So it seems like the dates that you can be confident about stretch back, I think you said, to 49 BPE or so. Are there dendrochronological techniques that could go back even further? If so, how far might you be able to go? Could you even, you know, link up with Bill Fitzhugh's Bronze Age stuff?
There's nothing that gets me more excited about working more in Mongolia than seeing archaeology, because that is the way to bridge our data. So, So we have some samples that go back to about 700 BCE, but we don't have enough to really be confident, you know, like we have very strict, you know, requirements for our dating. And so what we really need is to work with archaeologists that have wooden samples from that time period and try to push the record further back, because we love doing that. But it's, you know, that's a tough duty, but it has the mutual benefit of being able to give precise annual dates to archaeological sites. So, yeah, we're in.
Just something to add. I was going to raise my hand and ask him, but I don't have to do that. What about core samples? Would that help? That doesn't give you precise dates, but it might give you a
like from lakes and other sediments?
Yeah, around lakes and things like mm-hmm. that. You drill down, take a core sediment, and then there's plants and there's bio life, and it gives you a fairly...
Yeah, so one of the collaborators that's been working on our project has been doing that in the Orkhon Valley. She's been taking cores out of lakes, and the idea is, can we see some of these past droughts or wet periods that we see in the tree rings? Can we see that in the lake record? And she's still working that data up. It's much slower, I couldn't believe it, than our data, working with our data, but it is actually slower. And so far... for the few lakes she's looked at, she can see that one of the lakes nearly dried up during that late 1100s event, which was really interesting for us and really confirmed what we would have expected to see. But the lakes in that central part of Mongolia appear to be really, really dynamic. So some of the lakes are... the cores coming out of the lakes are 10,000 years of data, and some of them coming out are 3,000 years of data. So we're still working through like what exactly you can learn from each record. But yeah, that is another great data source.
Oh, that's interesting.
Just a quick comment that even if we get the climate records, you know, worked out, you know, the social scientists are really confused about whether lack of water or too much water is creating some kind of social problem. So like in terms of Genghis's empire and things like this, you can argue both ways, and papers have come out on both sides of this issue saying this is the reason there's too much water, or this is the reason there's not enough water. So you know, I'm not sure that we're going to have an easy solution even once we get the climate record figured out, because we just don't understand the social processes closely enough to be able to really see. And the events are quite rapid. You've got really quick changes from one year to another.
Yeah.
So I hope, but I don't promise.
No, that's totally true. And so one of the challenges with the lake sediment data is it just the resolution isn't fine enough to pick up some of the events that we think are important at the human scale. So, for example, this really dry period in the 800s that maybe is like in time associated with the sort of long, slow decline of the Uyghurs. There's nothing in the historical record that suggests they even noticed, you know? So what does that say? Like, is it so long and slow that they don't realize they're in this protracted drought and nobody talks about it? Or were they so resilient to it that it just didn't matter to them because they could just move wherever they needed to go? So yeah, it doesn't. It's fun to go back in time and be able to tell us like these really precise things about the past moisture conditions, but it doesn't necessarily tell us how people behaved and how it affected them. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask you if Cook or your group has looked at any of these oceanic cycles, like the Pacific decadal oscillation. It doesn't seem like ENSO has any effect, but the PDO or some of the others might have a relationship with drought, just as, of course, Cook showed with drought and the Dust Bowl.
Right, right. So that's a great question and something that I've been asking other climatologists for some time. So, and I think the main response is that Mongolia is so continental that those kinds of effects are just really, really distant to its location. And so they're not that influential. Having said that, though, it does seem like during really extreme years, and this may be related to ENSO a little bit, that the monsoon fails. And when the monsoon fails, that can potentially impact moisture delivery to Mongolia. But that's, I mean, I'm just sort of like saying that because I see that, but we don't have real data to support it yet.
I want to say one stupid thing that's going to take too many words. We'll have to have a break here in just a few minutes, but I think I have to run away. I just want to say I'm from, just exactly to this question, I'm from North Dakota and from a farm right next to a lake, and the lake is called Stump Lake, the Lake of Stumps. And that's a stupid or miraculous kind of name for a lake. What it means is that lake, that area, which is like the Great Salt Lake in Utah, it's a basin that doesn't drain. But it goes through incredible fluctuations in terms of wet and dry cycles. In 1993, I left Mongolia in 1993, and there was unprecedented rain in Mongolia that particular year. And then I came back to North Dakota, and there was unprecedented rain in North Dakota. And there's been a wet cycle there for some time. And it's this little basin. The Canadian watershed comes down and it drains up into the Hudson, so it doesn't go into the Mississippi system. But anyway, that whole area has been undergoing this kind of wet cycle since 1993, exactly. And then once this started, I went to the geological record, and you can see that a funny little clock, like 150-year cycles, it just goes like that. The lake comes up and the lake goes down. And the reason I asked about the core samples is because they've drilled those, and that's how you see this little. So I don't know if that has anything to do with what goes on in Mongolia or greater climate things, or if that has something to do with the ocean or not. I just wanted to say that. And with that, maybe we can take a 10-minute break. So.